All right, well, good afternoon, everyone. We're going to start with the song I've done the last couple of years. And there's a couple of words up there you can read as I begin. But I just want to encourage everyone to, I know that coming from, it's a noon service, so many of us are coming from work or taking a lunch break or something like that. And I just want to encourage us to take a deep breath. Also, I need to do that. And this song is different from most songs in church because it's not a corporate worship song. It's it meets us individually. It's a meditative song. So just as you listen, I suggest that you picture the image being spoken about standing at the cross as the little boy that Jesus raised from the dead, as Lazarus, that we would meet him as a child and as a friend, and that this would draw us in love to him in this time. So just, I just hope that it blesses you in that way.
Thank you. Friends, good afternoon. Welcome to worship with us here at University Lutheran Chapel. As we observe Good Friday, our gathering will be built around what we typically call the Tenebrae worship gathering, where we remember Christ's death by reflecting on his seven words that he speaks from the cross. And so you'll hear those read in just a moment, and there'll be reflections on each of those words. We're grateful that you could gather with us this afternoon. One thing that will be just a little bit different is we will actually have our offering here at the front end of our worship gathering, so that once we begin sort of our reflections on the seven words of Christ, that can kind of be our focus for the time. But before we do that, it's right for us to begin in the name of the God who calls us here to himself, the name of the God who sent his son Jesus into the world to go to the cross for our sake. So we begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with our offering as we sing our opening hymn.
Jesus before Pilate. Then the whole company of them arose and brought him before Pilate, and they began to accuse him, saying, "We found this man misleading our nation and forbidding us to give tribute to Caesar, and saying that he himself is Christ, a king." And Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And he answered him, "You have said so." Then Pilate said to the chief priests and the crowds, "I find no guilt in this man." But they were urgent, saying, "He stirs up the people, teaching throughout all Judea, from Galilee even to this place."
When Pilate heard this, he asked whether the man was a Galilean. And when he learned that he belonged to Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him over to Herod, who was himself in Jerusalem at the time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was very glad, for he had long desired to see him, because he had heard about him, and he was hoping to see some sign done by him. So he questioned him at some length, but he made no answer. The chief priests and the scribes stood by, vehemently accusing him. And Herod, with his soldiers, treated him with contempt and mocked him. Then, arraying him in splendid clothing, he sent him back to Pilate. And Herod and Pilate became friends with each other that very day. For this they had been at enmity with each other. Pilate then called together the chief priests and the rulers and the people and said to them, "You brought him to me. This man is one who was misleading the people. And after examining him before you, behold, I did not find this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither did Herod, for he sent him back to us. Look, nothing deserving death has been done by him. I therefore will punish and release him."
But they all cried out together, "Away with this man and release to us Barabbas," a man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection, started in the city and for murder. Pilate addressed them once more, desiring to release Jesus, but they kept shouting, "Crucify! Crucify, crucify him!" A third time he said to them, "Why? What evil has he done? I have found no guilt. Deserving death, I will therefore punish and release him." But they were urgent, demanding with loud cries that he should be crucified. And their voices prevailed. So Pilate decided that their demand should be granted. He released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, for whom they asked, but he delivered Jesus over to their will.
And as they led him away, they seized one Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from the country, and laid on him the cross to carry it behind Jesus. And there followed him a great multitude of the people and of women who were mourning and lamenting for him. But turning to them, Jesus said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For behold, the days are coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do these things when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?"
Two others who were criminals were led away to be put to death with him. And when they came to the place that is called the Skull, there they crucified him. And the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And they cast lots to divide his garments.
You know, when we pause and we take a look at these first words that Jesus speaks from the cross, they're really quite extraordinary. And I think you kind of get a sense of that from that first reading. I'm sure you're thankful that we didn't make you stand for all 34 verses of that gospel lesson. But what it really does is it sort of sets the entire background of Jesus speaking these words, "Father, forgive them." Right? We've seen what Jesus has endured to this point. We know that Jesus is here because he's been betrayed by one of his closest followers. We know that he has been falsely tried, falsely accused by his own people and run through a kangaroo court that lands him before the leaders of Rome. And even as they find no fault in him, he is handed over to be killed. Before they get there, he's beaten, he's mocked, he's spit upon. He's forced to carry his own cross to a trash heap to be killed there. And as he's finally hanged on that cross, what's the first thing that he says? He looks out on the people who have put him there and he says, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." Now, on the one hand, that this perhaps seems shocking, like how could he utter these kinds of words? However, when we examine them in light of all of Jesus' life and all of Jesus' teaching, they really don't come as much of a surprise at all. Jesus reflects that he is about forgiveness. It's at the center of his teaching. It's at the center of every time he heals. It's at the center of many of his parables is the call to be a people of forgiveness. Jesus, from beginning to end, demonstrates that he's about forgiveness. But it's here in this moment that he really practices what he preaches. It's here that he reflects just how much he is about forgiveness. Because even here at this moment, even here, when he has suffered this kind of mistreatment, Jesus is still crying out these same words, "Father, forgive them." What he reveals to us is what the entire cross is about. That just like Jesus' life is about forgiveness, the cross is about forgiveness. Now, you might hear that and you might think to yourself, okay, yeah, like it seems pretty apparent that the people who killed Jesus are in need of forgiveness. But what about you and me? Right, we didn't directly hang Jesus on the cross in this way. Are we really in need of forgiveness? Right, it's easy for us to tell ourselves that our lives really aren't all that bad, that we're really not in need of much forgiveness. Sure, we're not perfect, right? We're simply human. None of us is perfect, but do I really need forgiveness? Do I need this kind of forgiveness? Do I need God's Son suffering and dying on a cross kind of forgiveness? Right? And miss me with all of your silly rules and regulations from this ancient book. Like, we all know that those are just sort of an age-old standard that no one really believes anyway. Do we really need forgiveness? The theologian John Stott, he responds to this in what I think is a rather profound way. He says this. He says, "The Bible accepts the fact that men have different standards. The Jews have the law of Moses, the Gentiles have the law of conscience, but all men have broken the law they know and fallen short of their own standard. What is our ethical code? It may be the law of Moses or the law of Jesus. It may be the decent thing or the done thing or the conventions of society. It may be the Buddhist Noble Eightfold Path or the Muslim's five pillars of conduct. But whatever it is, we have not succeeded in observing it. We all stand condemned." Did you catch his point here? He's saying, hey, if you want to play the moral relativism game, right, the Bible's willing to play that with you here for a moment. If you want to say, you know what, live your truth, I'll live mine, right, what Scripture reminds us again and again is that we have not even lived out our own truths. We have not even met our own standards that we have set for ourselves. Choose whatever path you want to follow it. None of us have actually met the standard. The reality is we all fall short, as Paul reminds us. That sin is universal and it is inescapable. That every single one of us stands in need of forgiveness. And the only shelter from this reality is the very words that Jesus speaks here in these moments. Because these words that he speaks are not only spoken for the people who nailed him there. The words that Jesus speaks, he speaks to you and to me. He looks upon us. He looks upon our sin and he says, "Father, forgive them. They don't even know what they're doing." Friends, the cross is about forgiveness. Jesus is about forgiveness. And friends, his forgiveness is for you. Amen.
And the people stood by watching. But the rulers scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself. If he is the Christ of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged railed at him, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." And he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And he said to him, "Truly, I say to you, the day today you will be with me in paradise."
Please be seated. "Today you will be with me in paradise." Now in the second reading, Jesus is being mocked. We have the Pharisees who are saying, "If you are the Christ, come down off the cross and we'll believe." The Roman soldiers as well are doing the same, saying he could save others but not himself. On top of that, even Pilate himself puts an inscription above the cross saying, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Now truly, when Pilate was questioning Jesus, we do find out that, sure, we could say Jesus is the King of the Jews, but he's more than that. He is the Messiah, the one who was talked about throughout the Old Testament by the prophets and the law, but he's more than that. He'd not come to form some rebellion against the Romans, but he came to bring in a new kingdom. A heaven on earth, you might say. Now, going along, we see that two criminals are crucified with Jesus. In Luke, they're called criminals. In some of the other gospels, they're referred to as robbers or thieves. More than likely, they were also partakers of the insurrection that Barabbas had taken part in. Now, as the reading goes on, we see that one of the criminals starts to blaspheme Jesus, saying, "If you are the Messiah, save yourself and us." But the other turns to him and rebukes him. He says, "Do you not fear God? Truly any man who did fear God, who was in the midst of being crucified or being put to death, his thoughts weren't on insulting others. His thoughts would be fixed on God and wanting to make sure he's right with God. The criminal goes on to say, "We are receiving what we deserve, but this Jesus of Nazareth, he is innocent." With this criminal is making a confession of his own sin by saying that what he's receiving is what he deserves for his crimes. He then turns to Christ and says, "Lord, remember me in your kingdom." Now, on top of his confession of sin, he's also demonstrating his faith by believing that Christ is the Messiah. And with this, Jesus turns to him and says, "Today you will be with me in paradise," administering the absolution of his sins. Now, what does Jesus mean by paradise? He, of course, is referring to the heavenly realm, where life is a return to the paradise that God had created in the Garden of Eden, when everything was perfect, or everything was good, or even very good, as God says at the end of the creation. "For there is no death, there is no suffering, and we have that perfect relationship that we had with God in the garden. For this is what Jesus brings us. This indeed is our faith, that by trusting in Christ, we too will be with him in paradise. And not on the account of our own merit or our own suffering or our own justification, as if we could ever justify ourselves, but on the account of what Christ suffered for us and died for us and all that he has done for us. Amen."
But standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home.
So I think it's safe to say that generally speaking, there's something deeply profound and mysterious about a mother's love for her child or her children. I was talking with a friend of mine a couple of days ago whose mom is dying from cancer right now. And he said to me, "You know, I knew it was coming. I know my mom is older and that this would kind of inevitably happen." And he said, "But Gabe, I've just been thinking lately about the fact that there are very, very few people in this world that think of you daily. But your mom is one of them. And he said, it's just hard to think of losing that. And this is just true, right? And I understand, I know not everyone's relationship with their mom is perfect, and perhaps for some of you it's a deeply painful relationship. But again, generally speaking, there is something about the persistent love of a mother. And we see this in our text. Who is it that John listed first as standing by Jesus' cross? It's his mother. It's his mom. She was with him until the very end. Mary is there watching her son die, not just die, but be crucified. You think about her perspective, the resurrection hasn't happened yet, and she's got no guarantee that it's going to, and so she's just standing there helplessly watching her son be tortured to death. And so, of course, we recognize at the crucifixion that Jesus is suffering, but we can also see at the foot of his cross, so is Mary. And I think it's so often in our moments of suffering, in our moments of pain, that we go looking for answers. We go looking for certainty to make sense of it all. In her article, Bridges to the Sacred, writer Stephanie Phillips shares how in the midst of the strain and struggle of adolescence, her teenage son recently shared with her that he has denounced his faith and is now an atheist. And she said that she's not thrilled about this, but that she's also not too worried. She writes these words. He's doing on the outside what I've spent much of my inner life doing, looking for a place to belong, a home within the chaos of the world, a port of certainty amidst all the questions without answers, and a group to swear allegiance to that seems to provide all that. And of course, don't we all do that? We try to find a place to belong. We try to find a home. We try to find some semblance of certainty in the midst of our struggles, in the midst of our pain. And so it's so absolutely fascinating to me, though, that Jesus, in the midst of his suffering, in the midst of his pain, isn't looking to get out of it, isn't trying to find some security or certainty or some place to call home. No, instead, he's looking out for his mom. And he sees her in her suffering, and he finds her a home. He finds her a place to belong. And he says to his best friend, hey, this is your mom now. Take her into your home. And he gives her somewhere to belong to once he's gone. I have gone to Good Friday services like this my entire life. I have preached this exact text at least 10 times. And I remain continually in awe of Jesus' care for others while enduring the weight of the cross, in particular his care for his mom in this moment. And it's in that awe that inspires me to draw near to him again and again in the midst of my own struggles. See, Stephanie Phillips closes up her piece with these words. She says, I long for my son to renounce atheism and truly, deeply know the God who made him and loves him beyond description as the source of all his meaning and location of all his belonging. Until then, I trust that he who began a good work in him will carry it to completion. Until then, I will rest in that faithfulness that has never failed me. Until then, I will take solace in the fact that atheism may be his current landing spot, but it has never inspired his awe. And I know that awe can be a bridge between the profane and sacred. Friends, in the midst of your pain and your struggles, may you find your home in awe of the one whose love for you is so great that he endured the cross for your sake. Amen.
Oh.
The fourth word, the death of Jesus. Now, from the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?" That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And some of the bystanders hearing it said, "This man is calling Elijah."
This is sort of a strange thing for Jesus to say, given what we believe about him, isn't it? Like Jesus here, he's crying out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" How can this be possible, given that we, the church, we confess that Jesus is God, right? He is God, right? We believe that he is the Son of God. He is begotten of the Father from all eternity, being of one substance with the Father. He is God. How can he be forsaken by God? I mean, even if we just sort of chalk it up to, well, Jesus is quoting from Psalm 22, it's still a strange thing for him to utter, given that he is God. But I do think that what might seem strange for Jesus is perhaps all too familiar for us. That I think every single one of us, even though we have not been crucified, we have felt forsaken by God. Whether it's because of enduring chronic illness, the loss of a loved one, the darkness of depression, the reality of human suffering, it causes us to feel that if there is a God, he has almost certainly forsaken me. Or if we look at the reality of the world around us that's filled with violence and hatred, poverty and injustice of every kind, we can't help but join in this cry, my God, why have you forsaken me?" This is the cry of anyone who has been confronted by evil in the world. But if God here, God in Jesus, if he is crying out these words, then that means somehow, strangely and mysteriously, even that space where it feels like we have been forsaken by God, who is present there? That if God is forsaken by God, then that means even in that forsaken space, we find God's presence, God's nearness. In this, Jesus fulfills not only the words of Psalm 22, but the words of Psalm 139, where David says, "Where shall I go from your spirit? Where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there." Even when we feel forsaken, even when we feel abandoned by God, what we find here on the cross in these words of Jesus is even there in that space, God is near. One of the messianic titles that's given to Jesus at the announcement of his birth is the title Emmanuel. And it maybe feels odd to make reference to something we typically remember during Advent. But perhaps you know is that Emmanuel means God with us. And again, while we typically remember this during Advent and the season of Christmas, it isn't until we see Emmanuel hanging on the cross that we discover how far these words extend. God is with us. Where? Everywhere. Even in our suffering, even in our sin, even in our doubt, even in the moments when we feel forsaken, friends, God is with us. Friends, no matter where you are this afternoon, no matter where you find sin present in your life, no matter how strong or how weak your faith is in this moment, friends, hear this good news. Hear the news that Jesus' words reveal. God is with you. Amen. Stand as we sing together.
After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said to fulfill the scripture, "I thirst." A jar full of sour wine stood there, so they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth.
Please be seated. The 2023 film, The Book of Clarence, is about the 13th apostle, Clarence. Now, if I say that and you're like, I didn't know there was a 13th apostle, you are right, there wasn't. It is a fictional story rooted in the New Testament era, though, about a young man named Clarence who seeks to be an apostle of Jesus and actually to be a Messiah himself. In order to make some money. And in her review of this film in Salon, the writer Asha French reviews this film alongside sort of a broader reflection of the tragic death of her own brother. See, Asha French grew up in a redlined neighborhood in West Louisville. And this neighborhood was filled with pollutants from nearby chemical industries, in which inhabitants who lived there as a result were 7 times more likely to have heart disease and 4 times more likely to have COPD. And her brother died an untimely death from a heart condition that he developed because he grew up in this redlined neighborhood. And so after the movie was over, French's friend asked her what she thought of the movie. And with her brother's unjust death in her mind, French said these words, "I liked the movie. Mine is a critique of the gospel. Give me a gospel where the Romans die." And I think we can understand where French is coming from. Right, that we see injustice in our world, we see oppression in our world, we see people treated unfairly, we see the strong crush the weak. Perhaps some of you have experienced that at one level or another yourself. And then this Good Friday, we look at Jesus on the cross, and we see him up there, and we hear him say, "I thirst." And it can maybe feel a little bit disappointing. And maybe we see ourselves suddenly alongside the impenitent thief next to him saying, hey, if you're the Messiah, do something. Save yourself. Save us. Give me a gospel where the Romans die. Theologian Stanley Hauerwas writes, in Jesus I thirst, we confront again our desire to have a God that would not save us by a cross. We keep hoping that if the one who suffers on the cross is in some way connected to God, then there must be some remainder, there must be something saved in reserve, that the God who thirsts will find a way to escape from the cross. But of course, he doesn't. Instead, he's given a sponge with sour wine mixed with vinegar. This is not a fine wine that he's given. It is not the wine of the wealthy. This is the cheap wine of the common man. It was probably actually there for the soldiers. But of course, it makes sense, right? That the one who was born in a stable, the one who touched the lepers, the one who dined with sinners, the one who fed the hungry poor, the one who had no place to lay his head, spends one of his last moments drinking the wine of the poor. And so, friends, it'd be so convenient to tell you that the way to justice in this world is through a triumphant Jesus who gets down from his cross and undoes all the harm humanity has ever done to one another throughout the ages, that he's going to come down and get rid of all the bad guys. But that isn't what happens. Instead, Jesus continues to identify with the poor, the oppressed, what the theologian Howard Thurman called the disinherited. And he identifies with them all the way to his last breath. Why? Because if Jesus got rid of all the bad guys, we'd all be in trouble. Instead, Jesus drinks all of our humanity down to the last drop. And he meets us in our lowliness, and he meets us in our injustice, so that you can know, no matter how dark this world can seem, God is not far from the cries of the oppressed and the downtrodden, but is in fact revealed there. So you can know, no matter how far gone you think you are, he meets you there to redeem you and to save you. Amen.
Sacred heaven.
When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
You know, when we hear Jesus say these words, "It is finished," I can't help but ask, what is finished? Like, Jesus, could you please tell us what exactly is finished? What exactly is done by your death on the cross? Is he talking about his life is finished? His work is finished? Is it something about the fulfillment of the scriptures? What does he mean by it here? As you see on the screen, the Greek word tetelestai, which is what we see translated, it is finished. Can be understood in sort of two ways. First, it is to complete an activity or process. Or second, is to carry out an obligation or demand. But it still does kind of beg the question, still, what is the it here, right? What activity is completed here at the death of Jesus? Well, presumably it's God's activity is completed. What obligation here is being fulfilled and carried out? Well, it seems to be that it would be God's obligation is fulfilled and carried out. In other words, the cross is the completion of, the fulfillment of all of God's work and the carrying out of all of the demands of the law, such that Cyril of Jerusalem says this about Jesus' words here. When he had drunk the wine mingled with myrrh and vinegar, he said, "It is finished. For the mystery has been fulfilled. The things that are written have been accomplished. Sins are forgiven." Sins are forgiven. Because God's work is completed, because God's demands have been fulfilled and carried out, friends, because of this, sins are forgiven. And what that means is because Jesus' work is finished, because God's work is finished, that means your work is finished too. You don't have to spend your days trying to prove yourself to God or to anyone else, because, friends, it is finished. Jesus has fulfilled everything. Jesus has completed everything, meaning that you can go as one who's been set free. You can go as one who's been forgiven. You can go and rest in the promise that Jesus proclaims, that it is finished. Amen. Let's stand as we sing together.
was now about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over the whole land, until the ninth hour, while the sun's light failed. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last. Now when the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God, saying, "Certainly this man was innocent." And all the crowds that assembled for this spectacle, when they saw what had taken place, returned home beating their breasts. And all his acquaintances who had followed him from Galilee stood at a distance watching these things.
Please be seated. So here's some things we modern Western people don't like about Christianity. A list I made. One, the doctrine of sin, that you sin and are morally culpable for sinning. Two, original sin, that you have a proclivity inside of you to choose the bad instead of the good. Three, the wrath of God. Four, the exclusivity of Christ. Five, judgment. Six, hell. Here's some things that the cross is about. The doctrine of sin, original sin, the wrath of God, the exclusivity of Christ, judgment, hell. See, we'd never say it out loud, but let's just be honest. We would like to not go into the sort of messy business of the cross. It's a bit heavy. It's a bit weighty. We'd rather kind of avoid it if we could. We would much prefer this sort of a message that Richard Niebuhr put it. We'd prefer a message of a God without wrath who brought men without sin into a kingdom without just judgment through the ministrations of a Christ without a cross. Isn't that nice? That's nice. Just a bunch of good people. We're just a bunch of good people getting a hug from our grandfather in the sky as Jesus sort of gently comforts us when things get tough. Instead, the message of the cross says that we were so lost in our sins, so dead in our trespasses, so bent towards evil against a holy and just God, that when God came in the flesh, when love was incarnate among us, we killed him. We killed him. See, this is the thing. I say that, and we want to distance ourselves from that. We're going to distance ourselves from those who put Jesus on the cross. And so we say, hey, it was the religious and political leaders of Jesus' day that nailed him to the cross. And of course, at one level, that is historically accurate. That's true. But at a deeper level, friends, it was all of us. It was humanity. We just sang it. It was my sin that held him there. Theologian Gerhard Ferdy puts it like this: we must not obscure the fact that we did it. We did not choose Jesus. We rejected him. In the end, no one stood with God, whether it was out of religious incredulity, defensiveness, disappointment, antipathy, cowardice, fear, avarice, lust for power, or even just the sentimental pity of the daughters of Jerusalem makes little difference in the end. Jesus was one from whom we hid our faces. God died alone. And so, friends, you can look at the news or you can look in the mirror, but you know we are capable of unspeakable things. As Fleming Rutledge puts it, had he died in a more merciful, less deliberately dehumanizing way, it would not be possible to see in his death the sum of all horrors. And yet, friends, this is the whole scandal of the cross. This is the whole point of today, that God's judgment against the sin that nailed Christ to the cross didn't fall on us, didn't fall on you, it fell on his son. That God uses death to bring us to life. He uses sin to achieve righteousness. He transforms our violence into his perfect peace. He enters hell that you might inherit heaven. And so as Jesus commits his spirit to the Father with his last breath, he abolishes all your sins committed against him. And so friends, may you go from this place this afternoon forgiven and free. May you find the peace, love, grace, and joy of God, not in spite of the horror of the cross, but on account of it. Amen.
Please stand.
We pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.